Well, the focus on training and use of force policy didn't just last all day today. It was also a primary focus late last week, and it's going to continue most likely into tomorrow with state testimony. So tonight, in addition to hearing from our legal experts, we're also going to introduce you to a former police trainer to have a discussion about what she saw and heard in this testimony. Here's Kent.
Days of testimony from MPD leadership have delved deep into officer training and policies like use of force and how they've changed over the years. But one former trainer says the underlying principle has remained constant.
Use of force has not changed that much. There have been different tools, but the basic bottom line is that when you are using force, you use the force until the resistance stops. That's it.
Mylan Masson is the former director of the law enforcement program with the state of Minnesota at Hennepin Technical College, and she's rewatched the events of May 25th from every angle.
In the beginning, if things were going out of control and they were trying to control him and he was resisting, didn't want to get into the car. And now once he is handcuffed, he's on his stomach and he is no longer resisting. They have him under control. Then you need to readjust. You either get him up, turn him to your side, find out what's going on. If he does need medical attention, he's not breathing, you need to adjust and maybe start CPR.
It sounds like the defense is saying that some of those things might not have happened because the officers were afraid of the crowd or concerned about the crowd. Is that part of training? Is that something that resonates with you when you hear that argument?
Yes, the crowd is, in this particular situation, looked like they were very much under control, but that can change so quickly. That's why I believe Chauvin kept looking at the crowd and not necessarily at the person he was arresting or even at the other officers. He just kept looking at the crowd.
But Masson says if officers are in a hostile situation, they have a responsibility.
The crowd becomes active towards you, you need to get more help in there. And you are in control of that person, you are in charge, you need to protect them in any way, shape, or form you can. And that may be medical aid.
So many times cases like this are what cause some of those changes in training and policy. Do you see or hear of potential gaps now that will still have to maybe be addressed going forward?
I think one of the things that might change is that give the other officers, permission to stop an action, even if they are your superiors, so that they would have the right, the authority, the protection from the department to say, I need to stop this and this is what I'm going to do. Those two other officers who were brand new, they were being guided by a superior in a certain extent, and they needed to have permission, and so did Tao, to be able to stop what they saw could be wrong.
What would you tell the next generation of officers about this case?
When the resistance stops, you stop your use of force. Also, I always used to tell the students, whatever you do, make sure you can put it on the 10 o'clock news. And that means if you use of force, make sure you use it properly.
Now, Masson says this intense focus on policies and procedures playing out on a live streaming telecast right now could potentially have benefits beyond the Chauvin trial. She says it may help the public understand just how much information and training officers are having to process in real time every single day. Jana?
Ken, she talked about something that I've heard talked about over the last 10 months when it comes to the other officers not doing all that much to stop what was going on. She talked about training them. And that is something that obviously will be central to the cases, not the training, but what they did or didn't do in their trial in August. Is she saying that they're not trained or they're not allowed to stop something like that from happening right now?
Well, I clarified with her after that and wanted to really pin that down because certainly that would be concerning. She says that's not the case. Officers can speak up, but this is one of those unspoken things. I think a lot of people can understand if you're with a superior, you tend to default to them. What she's talking about is putting in the training, specifically training those young officers that they should step up if they see something wrong. There's that little bit of a difference there. So certainly you can see why there may be court cases coming up and that would be argued in court, but she wants to kind of eliminate that doubt that any officer might have going forward.
Okay, so just making sure it is clear in the training that other officers can say, no, 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 we're not going to do this.
Yeah, she basically said officers certainly have that right to step in and they're all trained on proper procedure, but there may be this unspoken rule to kind of default, and she wants to make sure that that is clarified as not something that would be acceptable going forward.
All right, Kent, thanks so much. We'll be right back.